on AWS, the loft, for making the space available to us and come here tonight. And thank you for everyone, the opportunity to be here tonight, for coming. We put these on for you. You're showing up means that we're doing the right thing, and we really appreciate that. Tonight, before we get started, we have our usual requests, which is silence your cell phones. Do not eat snacks and noisy wrappers, or that make a lot of noise during the presentation. And as much as possible, this space is equipped differently in terms of microphone. We normally request that you use a microphone for questions that may not be possible tonight, so please make yourself heard when you ask your question. I also believe it would be ideal if you don't just call out your questions, if you ask, sort of try to get the attention of the speaker, because then we will be sure that your question is not about to be answered. Our next meeting topic will actually be sorry, I just edited this and I feel like it disappeared underneath. I was wondering if I edited the wrong document. Yes, the next general meeting will be on October 19th. Julian Dunn from the Chef Company, or that's a difficult way to say it, but they are the company that maintains Chef, and they are chef.io, so there you go. From the Chef Company, will be presenting Habitat, a new build and runtime system for packaging, deploying, and running modern software. I think if you're interested in infrastructure in dynamic stuff like that, that would be very interesting. That is up on the meetup page, so if that interests you, please come on to that. Our next workshop will be, I didn't forget to get the date. Our next workshop will be the coming Tuesday. It was last night, so it's two Tuesdays from now, right? So two Tuesdays from now. Please ask Dave or Rob if you have any questions about it. Gentlemen, if you could raise your hands. Davis right here. And that will be from 6 to 8 p.m. at City College at 138 in Amsterdam. Again, look at the meetup page for the exact date and time. In case you missed it, you can grab the free Linux distro DVDs from the table in the back over there. If you're curious, they are yours to take. Is it Debian 8.6? Sorry, 8.6. For some reason, I'm still thinking back to 5 whenever I think Debian, and that's the wrong time to go. It's there as you can. Pick one up if you are so interested. They are free for you to take and to try out at home or wherever. Yes, it's not a library, it's yours to keep. After the presentation, we'll be heading over to Ken's Broom Street Bar that's just up the corner here on Broom Street and West Broadway. And we'll be having drinks.
If anybody's on Twitter who follows us, please tag us. We're at NYLUG.
Okay, yes, and if you are on Twitter and that's your thing, please tag us. We're at NYLUG. We appreciate it, just makes us more visible for these talks. Alright,
I forgot that. Do you have questions at the end or during the hour?
So yes, please raise your hand, make yourself visible, and questions will be asked during the presentation.
And afterwards,
and before, and anytime you can get his attention. Alright, so here we have Neal Walfield giving us a talk, an advanced introduction to GNUPG. I believe you all know that. That's why you're here. So please welcome him. Thank you very much.
I'll try the mic, but I don't really like holding it up to my face like this. So thank you everyone for coming, and thank you for having me. I want to talk today about GNUPG, and this isn't your normal introduction to GNUPG, how to make a key. I'm going to get deep into the details with you, so that way you understand how it works. And so if you don't know GNUPG, then I apologize. You're going to get lost. So my talk is broken into four parts. The first part is talking about OpenPGP, the standard. So GNUPG builds on this. It's a packet format for exchanging encrypted and integrity checked messages. Then I'll get into GNUPG's architecture, how GNUPG itself is built, the different components, why GNUPG is not a library but a binary. I'll talk about some good practices, not best practices, but good practices that you can use in order to protect yourself and protect your key material. And then I'll get into some neat tricks that probably only a handful of you know, even though you may have been using GNUPG since 2000. So first, OpenPGP. OpenPGP is a data integrity service for messages and files. That basically means that we're able to encrypt the data and we're able to integrity check it. We can make sure that what somebody transferred was really what was transferred, or what was received was really transferred. OpenPGP is defined in RFC 4880, which was published in 2007, and we're currently working on a new version. There are a whole bunch of OpenPGP implementations, not only GNUPG. So if you're using, for instance, Android, you might be using OpenKeyChain in order to decrypt and integrity check messages that you receive. And of course, there are other ones. There's like OpenPGP, which is a Haskell-based implementation, and there's NetPGP and these sorts of things. But most people are familiar with GNU Keychain. The focus of the OpenPGP standard is on the message format, how to read, write, and verify messages, so the algorithms, and also defining the crypto algorithms that are used and what parameters to use. Note that the standard is not about defining crypto, we're just building on the existing crypto, which is, of course, best practices. Nobody should be building their own stuff. GNUPG, or OpenPGP in general, is good for data at rest. So what is data at rest? Data at rest is not instant messaging. So when you send someone a message in real time, then you're able to negotiate the parameters with your communication partner, which means that you can use the best algorithms, crypto algorithms that you support, the both of you. And you can also use forward secrecy and use keys that are ephemeral. OpenPGP is not designed for this use case. It's designed, for instance, for when you make a backup and you want to look at it 10 years later. It's impossible to have a communication between you and yourself in 10 years. Right, it's just a time paradox. There's no way to negotiate parameters across a 10-year time span. So this is a main difference, and this restricts a lot of the things that OpenPGP can do. But OpenPGP solves a very important problem, and we do the best around the limitations of what's possible. So you might think of OpenPGP more like TAR than, say, HTTP or SMTP or XMPP. And one of the main consequences of this design decision is that it becomes effectively impossible to phase out old algorithms. As I told you, you want to create a backup, you still want to read it 10, 20, 30 years later. We still have to support that stuff. And so that's why we still support, for instance, GNUPG 1.4, which has support for MD5 and using these old broken algorithms that nobody should be using. And even GNUPG 2.1, which is the newest version, supports a lot of the old stuff. So you can still read everything that you encrypted 15 years ago. And as I said, there's no way to do this interaction between encryptor and decryptor. When we encrypt a message to someone, we have to look at the key block, we have to figure out what parameters are supported, we can't ask the person who controls the key or the software that the person is using. You just have to assume that what's there is the best that's available. And a consequence is that there's no forward secrecy. So we're currently working on a new version of OpenPGP. There is the current RFC, which is 4880, and the new version is currently called 4880 bis. The old version was called 2440, so we're all really interested to see what number we're going to have, whether or not we're ready to do this times two thing. So
It gets big fast.
Yeah, but we're almost there. So if we release next year, the original intention was to release this summer, but that didn't happen. We're not halfway through. You know, things grow and people get interested in other things. But if we release next year, then we have a good chance of getting, 9760, I'm told. Can somebody verify them? No. Yeah, see, we're in the mid sevens, so I have a good chance of getting to 9,000. We're going to have a cool number for our next OpenPGP standard. The major goals of the new standard are not revolutionary, they're evolutionary. So there's a whole bunch of algorithms that we want to deprecate, including MD5. So anybody who is familiar with computers probably knows that MD5 is absolutely completely broken and that you can create a collision within just a few seconds. Even SHA-1 has been shown to be extremely weak, and so that's also being deprecated, and there's a whole bunch of other algorithms that we don't want to use anymore. But there are things that we do want to use, like ECC. So we want to deprecate RSA in 20 years, and the next new thing is ECC, and it looks to be much better, smaller keys, and all this other nice stuff. And the other major goal is to introduce a new key derivation function. There are more seats up here. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Six seats. Come on. Over there, there's some seats. Come on. There's still 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 people sitting in the back. And there are 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 seats. You have a choice. If you want to stand, you can stand. We're going to have a new key derivation function, so S2K is rather weak, and there has been a lot of work in this area since 2007, and so we're looking forward to that as well. So as I already mentioned, OpenPGP is a message-based format. That means that we have, or a packet-based format, so we have a bunch of packets, and you can append these packets to each other in almost any order. But it is required by the standard that the packets be ordered in such a way that it's possible to do unbuffered processing of the messages. And this is really critical for embedded systems, which don't have gigabytes of RAM and can't buffer everything. And so the packets are laid out in such a way that you're able to figure out what the key material is, and then decrypt the message or do integrity protection in just this single pass. There are 17 packet types that are defined by OpenPGP. There's, for instance, the symmetrically encrypted data packet, the public key encrypted session key packet. And then there are more common things like signature packets and public key packets. And we'll get into a little bit of what all those are in a minute. So we have this message-based or packet-based format. And then the second thing that the standard talks about are the algorithms. The most important algorithms, of course, are how you encrypt and decrypt a message, but also how do you generate a signature, how do you do a key derivation function, so how do you take a passphrase and turn that into a symmetric key, and this is done using S2K, and then how do you encode messages. So this is completely banal and nobody really cares about it, but it's super important because this is one of the most frustrating things when you're using OpenPGP is all the mangling that goes on, particularly in mail, and Outlook, for instance, is particularly bad about, or in Exchange, about messing with this stuff. So what does the encryption algorithm look like? Let's say we want to encrypt some data, so we have over here our data. Well, we're going to encrypt it using a session key, so we're going to use some symmetric cryptography like AES. And this key they're using. And this both decrypt this. So the size of the message that you have at the end is effectively independent of the number of recipients that you have, because all of the recipients get access to the same session key. So you can have gigabytes of data, and your message remains x gigabytes. It's not n times x gigabytes, where n is the number of recipients. And so, if you recall, we want to make sure that we can do single-pass processing. And in order to do that, we have to make sure the data, the encrypted data, comes last, and the session keys come first. So here we have our session keys. They come at the beginning, 1, 2 packets, and then we have our encrypted data. So let's look at an encrypted message. Up here, way up there, we're just echoing out some random data. And then I'm encrypting it to myself. So GPG2 minus E minus R, here's my key, 6300F2D9, and then some other random recipient. And then we're using GPG's list packet function in order to dissect the actual message and look at all of the different packets. And here we have two recipients, myself and someone else. And by the way, there's this nice feature that you can always encrypt to yourself using the encrypt to command in your gpg.conf file. So here, there are 5 packets. We have, let's see, we have the 1, 2 packets that are encrypting the session key, we have the actual data, then we have a compressed packet, the literal data packet, which contains the actual data. In this listing, we see some metadata that's important if you're examining the actual message, the offset within the stream, the type of the message, the size of the header, the size of the packet length. And then let's take a look at the different packets we have here. We have the 1-2 pub key encrypted packets. And you can see here that these do indeed belong to the public keys that I mentioned. And then we have our three packets, the encrypted data packet. This contains the data. It's an encapsulated packet, so this is actually nested. Even though you can't see it from the output here, this is a logically containing the compressed packet and the literal data packet. Likewise, the compressed packet is logically containing the literal data packet. And again, the order of the packets is such that we can do all the processing without having to buffer the data. One thing that's interesting here is that we have the encrypted packet and we're using MDC, which is a system for preserving the integrity of the message, so making sure that nobody can tamper with the encrypted data. MDS is called the Modification Detection System, and it is also defined by the OpenPGP standard. And MDS is really cool because you're able to verify the integrity of the encrypted data while preserving the anonymity of the person who encrypted the data. So normally you would do integrity checking by signing the data. This is sort of a hack which allows you to not have to sign directly. So the MDS packet, or the MDC packet, which is the end, normally it follows the encrypted data, but we don't see that here for technical reasons. So how does the modification detection system work? We have here our encrypted data header, and this is followed by the data that we're actually going to sign, or encrypt and sign. We start with some random data and a copy of that random data. And the reason we do this is a quick check to make sure that you have the right session key. So when you're doing decryption, you can use any key you want, right? An AES key is, for instance, a 32-byte key, and it's whatever, or 16-byte, sorry. So you have a 16-byte key. Any number, more or less, is valid. So how do we know that we have the right key? Well, we have to decrypt the whole thing. We have to do an integrity check, and if we have gigabytes of data, this can take a really long time to do. So instead of having to decrypt everything, we include some random data right at the beginning, we include a copy, and if you're using the wrong session key, well then the copy is going to not match the data, and then we're able to immediately identify that there was a problem. And this is, of course, convenient. So after the random data, we have the actual plain text that we want to encrypt, and that is technically the end of the encrypted data packet. But the encrypted data packet is followed by this MDC packet. So we have the MDC header, and then we have the actual signature. Now the MDC header is included in the data that we're going to sign, or hash in this case. And the reason for that is because we don't want an attacker to be able to extend or to truncate the encrypted data. So by including the MDC header here, we know what the data has to be at the end of the packet, and we have another integrity check. So let's move on to signing. That's the other major operation. When we do signing, we first output the hash parameters, so what hash we're using, any parameters that we might require for the hash, and then we simultaneously hash and output the message. At the end, we sign the hash using the sender's private key. So we use, for instance, SHA-1 to create a digest over the entire text. And then we only sign the actual hash. We don't sign the actual data. And again, this is for reasons of computational efficiency. Trying to sign gigabytes of data is very, very slow, whereas first doing a hash is very fast, and then signing a small block of data is very quick. And then at the very end, we output the signature. So how does this look like? Here we have four packets. Again, we're using GPG2-S, and we're listing the packets. And so first we see we have a compressed packet, which logically contains all of the other packets. We have the actual parameters. So in this case, we're using the 1-pass-sig packet, which identifies the key that is being used to sign all of the data. And of course, if you want to have multiple people sign it, it's perfectly reasonable to have multiple 1-pass-sig packets. But this introduces a potential ambiguity. So if I have a signature, and then I have another signature, how do I know whether the first signature is over the signature and the data, or just over the signature, or just over the data itself? All right, so I have signature one, signature two, and then I have the data. Is signature one just over the data, or over signature two and the data? Well, we have this flag here called last, and this tells us whether or not we're going to skip any following signature packets when computing the signature. And this is how, for instance, Debian is able to sign the releases, or have hundreds of developers sign the release. Everybody generates one of these one pass sig packets. They're all concatenated together, and they all have last set to zero, and they're only signing the actual data over here. So then we have the actual data to sign, which is a literal data packet, for instance, in this case. There's also detached signatures and these sorts of things, but here we have it in line. And we have different parameters, for instance, the mode, how the data is encoded. Right now we have binary text, or UTF-8. In the upcoming version of OpenPGP, we're going to support a type called M, which is MIME. So we're going to teach OpenPGP about about MIME. And so an OpenPGP parser is going to be able to pull apart a MIME message, identify further OpenPGP messages internally, and be able to process those. And that's really convenient, so you don't have to have your mail client send a message to your GPG process. GPG returns a MIME block. Your mail client sees, oh, there's another OpenPGP message inside. Let me send it back to GPG and get back additional output by including it all into a single system. It makes it really a lot easier and more efficient to parse it. We also have the file's last modification date and the file name, and this is useful for when you have an attachment in order to identify the file. At the very end, we have the actual signature, and again, this is essential for the way that we want to do processing, which is with no buffering. And for convenience, we repeat all of the parameters that we used, and then we have some additional subpackets that may be included here that include some metadata. How about public keys? How do we transfer public keys? Well, public keys are fundamentally not different from any other data in the OpenPGP world, right? We want to exchange them, and why not use the same format? So they also have their own packet type. And so if we want to export some key, let's say that the user ID is testing, and we just do export testing, and we can pipe it into GPG to list the packets again. So we're able to serialize the packets without a problem. And interestingly, the public key packet doesn't just include the key material. It includes a whole bunch of preferences and features that your GPG supports. And when somebody wants to send you a message, they look at your key, they see what features you support, and they choose the best algorithms that they also know about. And this is really important if you think about it. It means the only way for you to negotiate parameters with someone is to update your key block on the key server, or to make sure that you're integrating new versions of the keys periodically. It also means that you should periodically re-upload your key to the key server, so that way people know, okay, he's using GPG 2.1 now, he understands ECC signatures. I can send an ECC signature, and that's understood, or whatever it is. So we have first the public key packet, but we also have a public subkey packet. So you probably know that you have a primary key and you have a bunch of subkeys. In this case, we just have two. We have the public key and subkey. And then we have the self-signatures. So in order to make sure that the public key is actually controlled by someone, we have the self-signature. So you generate a signature over your own public key data using your private key, and that's included here. And that's where all the preferences are. We know that the preferences are real because it's signed by your private key, and therefore it must be authentic. Likewise, the subkey is also signed by the primary key, and this creates a linkage between the two keys. because there's nothing stopping anyone from pulling these packets apart and taking this particular subkey and injecting it into my key, for instance, and then you would go ahead and import it. But when you import it, you see that the self signature is not valid. Right? You have some primary key, and that primary key clearly didn't generate the self signature. And so this is how you do integrity protection. Inside of the signature packet, we have the user preferences and some properties and other supported features. And that's more or less the OpenPGP message format in all of 20 minutes or so. Now, the document itself is about 100 pages, and there are a lot more details, but you should now be prepared to understand how it works and explain this to other people. There'll be a quiz at the end, and I hear that if you get the questions right, you win a book, so I hope you're all paying attention. Now I want to switch gears and go from OpenPGP to an actual OpenPGP implementation, namely GNUPG, which is what I work on. And GNUPG's architecture is perhaps different from most programs. So normally, if you want to use some functionality, then you take it and you pack it into a library. In our case, we don't do that. And it's a very explicit decision, and it's based on important security concerns. GNUPG is a multi-server architecture. That means that we have a whole bunch of binaries that are communicating with each other using IPC, inter-process communication. GPG is explicitly not a library. If you want to use GPG from a library, then you use GPG-me. Lots of people don't do this, but nevertheless, GPG-me is very convenient, and it communicates with GPG for you. And not only that, it's been debugged. Now, that doesn't mean that there aren't still bugs in GPG-me, but we've written a whole lot of parsers. GPG-me is used by a lot of programs. Please don't write another library to interact with GPG. They're all broken. It's unfortunately not that funny because there are lots of programs that are trying to do secure stuff and they are interacting with GPG directly, not using this library. And that's unfortunate, right? Because we want these things to be secure. And each of these components are running their own address space. And that's essential for reducing bugs or reducing the impact of bugs. We can imagine that maybe you have GPG integrated directly into your, web browser or your mail client. And you can imagine that maybe your web browser or your mail client implements this little cute function called echo. And maybe echo takes a parameter and you can tell it how much data to return, like say 64 kilobytes of memory. And you can imagine a bug maybe, I know I can, that forgets to check the bounds. And it just returns, say, 64 kilobytes of data from the address space. And you could imagine somebody going ahead and taking advantage of this bug and then getting all of your private keys. It would be a really unfortunate situation to be in. It hasn't happened to GNUPG yet. And, I'm sorry?
It has happened in the wild.
Oh, it has happened in the wild?
Not to
GNUPG. Not to GNUPG. Oh, okay. That's unfortunate. Poor programmers.
You just described Hartley.
I described Hartley. Yeah. That might be the case. Yeah. I did, didn't I? So we put all of these components in their own address space. And so if there is something like Hartley in GNUPG, it effectively becomes impossible to exploit because you have so many levels of indirection. Now, does that cost you a little bit of performance? Yeah, maybe it costs you 10% performance. But you really don't want to breach your private keys. So here we have our app that's using GNUPG directly. This is bad, don't do this. Here we have your app that's using GPG-me, and that is talking to GNUPG, and that's good, and that's what we want. So we have this level of indirection here. And then GNUPG itself, it's not doing your public key cryptography. It's only doing, I think I actually have this one. Right. So GNUPG itself is doing the low security stuff. It's doing, for instance, session encryption and session decryption. It's doing encoding. It's doing things that are significantly lower security. On the other hand, we have GPG agent, which GNUPG talks to. And this is the high security component. We try to keep it as simple as possible, although there is some complexity there necessarily. And the GPG agent is managing your private keys and your passwords. It's doing the public key cryptography. And additional complex operations are delegated to the servers on the far right. You can imagine this separation as being similar to a PC and a smart card. So your PC is insecure, it's running lots of software, it's broken, there are viruses, and your smart card is a separate component. It's very simple, and this is what we strive for. In fact, it's possible to run GPG agent on a different computer, and the whole thing can work. Or you can run GPG agent as under a different user ID, and that provides additional protection. I'll get into how that exactly works a bit later. So one of the first major components that GPG agent talks to is the SC daemon. That's the smart card daemon. The smart card daemon interacts directly with the smart cards, or it uses, for instance, PCSC in order to talk to them. And if you're using a smart card, then you actually normally have to install this explicitly. The package is called SC daemon. It's not packaged by default by most of the distributions in the GNUPG binary. Next is pin entry. Pin entry is used for interacting with the user. It's, as its name suggests, it's used for getting passphrases and the pin, but it's also used for asking additional questions or providing warnings. The reason that we do this is that we don't know, or the idea is that we want to eventually support trusted window managers, so you can identify where the window was created, and that it was GPG agent that created this window and this password prompt, and you don't accidentally give your password to, for instance, Solitaire. It's could happen, right? Solitaire can do whatever it wants. In fact, Solitaire can read any file on your computer, including your GNUPG key, and Solitaire is able to open a network connection. And so it can upload your GNUPG key to any server that it wants. This is unfortunate, but it's the way that Unix was designed when the adversary was other users, not the actual programs. But there's a bright future, I think. Anyways, so pin entry, there are multiple implementations of pin entry. You can use something very simple like pin entry TTY. This is just a super simple implementation of pin entry, text-based, no libraries are linked effectively, rather secure. On the other hand, we have pin entry QT and pin entry GTK, and these integrate beautifully with the desktop environments, and they also integrate beautifully with about 40 to 50 different libraries. And that's not so good from a security perspective, but it looks pretty at least. And that's what people want. And then we have the directory manager. The directory manager is used for interacting with, for instance, the key servers, either using the HTTP, LDAP, or HTTP protocol, or whatever it is you're using. GPG agent never talks on the network by itself. This is essential in order to avoid any sort of bugs being directly exploitable. So this is delegated to DIR manager, and DIR manager is also a daemon that runs in the background. Just as a quick tip, you can search for keys directly on the key on the command line using search keys, and then you can receive the key by specifying the key ID or even better, the fingerprint. DIR manager also acts as a certificate in CRL cache and does some other network type things. So we have all these components, and they're talking to each other over IPC. And what are we using in order to communicate? Well, we're not using DBus. DBus is just way too complicated. We're using something that is as simple as it gets. Again, this is a very important security concern. The simpler it is, the better it is. So OSINT can either be used to talk to another process via a pipe. So for instance, when GPG agent starts pin entry, then it will do a fork exec, and it will talk to pin entry on STDIO or STDIN. It will talk and it will listen on STDIN. And the interface, and then the socket version is, for instance, when it's talking to DIR manager, which is a daemon, and that is available or can be found under a well-known name in the file system itself. It uses a Unix domain socket, and any component can then find it. Yeah, go ahead.
So, I'm sorry. Backing up a little bit, you said that the pin entry integrated well with about 50 or so libraries, and that created something that was pretty
but actually was a security risk. Is that because you think that by integrating with so many different libraries, that one of those libraries could actually endanger the security of the entry?
Yeah. So the question is, or the statement is, what happens when you integrate with all of these libraries? Does it cause a security problem? And the answer is yes. So if there's a bug in these programs, then they can go ahead and take, for instance, the passphrase and just send it over the network. And so Austin is a very simple interface. It's not a binary protocol, it's a text-based protocol. And I'm going to show you an example of it right here. You can run this on your laptop by yourself. All you have to do is type in pin entry at the prompt, and you get this back from pin entry. It says, okay, and there's some comment, which is not so important. Then we can use the command set prompt, and set prompt determines what is shown here. In this case, we want to say enter your password, and we get okay back. That means pin entry understood it. And then we do get pin. Get pin causes the window to actually be displayed. And the user types in something, presses OK, and then we get the data back, and it turns out that this passphrase is 123ABC. That's not my passphrase. My passphrase is a little bit longer. And so it's super easy, and you can even type in help, and you get a list of all the commands that pin entry knows about, or whatever is talking lib, the Austin protocol, and it's really super convenient. In fact, we have a program called GPG Connect Agent, that you can use to either connect to a running GPG agent or a running DIR manager process. You can interact with that. It has lib readline support. It's beautiful. If anybody's ever used dbus send, then you know how painful it can be to talk to processes ad hoc. In GPG world, this is so easy. And Austin is a library that we maintain. It's used by GnuPG, but anybody can use it. So I highly encourage you to check out libAustin and to use it in your next project if you need to do some sort of IPC. Now there's also a tool that you can use for gathering log entries and for analyzing them. It's called WatchGnuPG. If you want to enable logging in, for instance, GPG agent, then you would edit your GPG agent.conf file. You would add, for instance, log file. You would add the socket. Specify the debug level that you're interested in, and then you can use Wash GNUPG in order to gather the logs quite easily. So I've covered GNUPG's basic architecture. Of course, there's a lot more going on, but hopefully you have a basic idea of how it works. Now I want to again shift gears, and I want to talk about you, how you use GNUPG, and what you ought to be doing, or give you several options that you can choose from. So how do you manage your private key? This is an essential question, and it depends on who your adversary is. So the weakest model is doing an online private key. This means that you just store it on your hard drive, and again, as I spoke about before, you can use something like, or something like Solitaire can read your GNUPG key, you can send it over the network. So this is low security. You have to trust all of the software that you've installed locally. Better than an online key is an offline key. In this case, you're going to store your key on a smart card. So I happen to have a YubiKey. I have a YubiKey primarily out of historical reasons. These days, we recommend GNUK. GNUK is developed by Niva-san, who is a Japanese developer. And he does some work for us. He's been working on this for about 6 years. The schematics are all available. He uses off-the-shelf components that anybody can get, so it's easy to build it yourself. In fact, he doesn't like to sell it. He tells everyone that they should not buy one from him, instead they should go out and build their own. It's just a bunch of very simple components, they're not specialized. And this is essential because when you have specialized security components, then you have three-letter agencies that are interested in inserting backdoors. But if you have some simple 32-bit ARM processor, like an ARM3 core, and anybody can get one of these ARM3 cores, then it's pretty unlikely that all of these ARM3 cores have been backdoored. Another alternative that we recommend is the Nitro Key. That is based on the GNUK design, but it has a number of extensions and is not quite as free. Nevertheless, you can get GNUK from seed, seeed.com. Or you can order it from the Free Software Foundation. They have a shop, and they sell the GNU there, and you can order one. I highly recommend that. If you're going to do an offline key, then you have to basically do subkeys. This makes the setup slightly more complicated, but if you are willing to invest the time in an offline key, that's probably not a big deal. If you do an offline key, then you definitely need to think about storing backups someplace. So it's possible to generate these subkeys on the actual token itself. The issue then is that the tokens are devised so that you can't export the private key, right? If you lost your private key and somebody could read it, then it would be a bit of a security disaster. So these all have tamper resistance, and they can't even be read out by an electron microscope. But three-letter agencies probably can read them. So, you don't think so?
I agree.
Yeah, okay. So if you lose it, you definitely want to revoke it. And if it was your primary key, then it's going to be a bit of a pain in the butt in order to do key rotation. So keep backups of all of this stuff, so that way it is possible to do the revocation certificates and restore them. Now, doing an offline key is much higher security. The crypto can only be done when the key is actually inserted into the computer. But it's not quite perfect because you don't know what the actual operation is. The interface that is used for talking to the smart card doesn't provide a way to say what the content of the message is, so you don't actually know what you're signing, you don't know what you're decrypting, and some virus on your computer can go ahead and recognize, the user is about to do some sort of operation, and then get in between, and if you even cached your PIN, then you won't even notice, for instance, that it's decrypting all of these messages. But that requires an adversary who is pretty serious, right? You need a lot of effort in order to do this, and so the offline key is really a good way to protect yourself from all but the most committed adversaries. And if you have a smart card, it all of a sudden becomes much easier to explain crypto to people who don't understand crypto. You say, I have a key on this thing, on my keychain, that I can use to unlock the message, right? It's really a nice way to explain crypto. And so get one and spread the word. Now, if you're gonna do offline keys, how do you do it? Well, you're gonna need some other system. You're gonna have to have it installed, for instance, on a USB key, and you'll boot it up in order to be able to get access to your primary key, in order to sign messages, in order to do key rotation, and these sorts of things. So if you're going to do that, then use Tails. Tails is hardened. You could use Debian, you could use Fedora, there's all these live distributions. Just don't do it, just use Tails. This is what Tails was designed for, and it has everything installed that you probably need. One thing that Tails does, for instance, is that when you shut down the computer, it actually goes ahead and makes an effort to wipe the memory. So we'll go ahead and erase everything that was in memory multiple times, and hopefully your private key is no longer in memory. Now, how do you manage this key? You boot from the USB stick, and where do you boot it? Do you boot it on your normal laptop? Well, if you boot it on your normal laptop, then your normal laptop, the BIOS is more or less a virus, right? If you're running EFI, then who knows what's going on there. And It's probably unlikely that the EFI is reading out your private key, but who knows if you left your laptop in your hotel room and what the maid did. No, I'm serious. So this is sort of medium security solution. And for those of you who, do you raise your hand?
Yes, the old rule from basic crypto back in the old days, the master key is locked in the vault.
The master key is locked in the vault.
If you use a laptop to generate the base key,
yeah.
Lock it in your office vault.
You have an office vault? I don't have an office vault.
They aren't that expensive.
Yeah, but I think whoever's going to steal my laptop is going to be able to open the vault. But, I mean, they're going to have to get through my passphrase. They're going to have to get through a whole lot of stuff. So getting through the vault is not going to be a serious problem. Still, it's probably a good idea for those of us who are extremely paranoid. I'm not quite that paranoid. I'm really paranoid. I think there is a three-letter agency or multiple agencies that are out to get me. But I still don't, by the way, video camera, hi. I don't lock my dedicated offline laptop in a vault. But where can you get a dedicated offline laptop cheap? On eBay. There are IBM X40s and X60s, which are really nice laptops, and they cost just, say, $50 or so. Yeah.
How about you?
A Raspberry Pi? Yeah, sure, you can use a Raspberry Pi. But the problem is that you can't use Tails because Tails only works on x86 and a Raspberry Pi is ARM. So, of course, you can use a Raspberry Pi, but you have compromises. So, and then you have a protection monitor and all this other stuff. So you get your preferably x86-based old PC. You get out your epoxy, you insert the epoxy into the Ethernet port, into an all but one of the USB ports, you remove the wireless card, and some other stuff. And now you have a more or less secure laptop. And I say more or less because you still have to transfer data to the secure laptop in order, for instance, to sign a key. And how do you do that? Well, you use, for instance, USB. And most of you probably know about bad USB, and if you're significantly paranoid, then you're very careful to not let anybody use your USB keys because you're worried about getting infected. Although there are USB condoms available, I've heard, if you want to charge, so think about that. So you take your USB key that has never been inserted into any other computer except for your desktop and your offline computer, and then you transfer bad USB to your offline laptop. So, nothing's perfect, but still, this is the way to go. Throw the USB key away.
But you small USB key, throw the bloody thing away?
Yeah, but you start on your own desktop, right?
You start on the master machine.
No, you can't start on the master machine, because you need to transfer the public key from the from the internet onto your offline computer.
Yeah.
So at some point you have to take a used USB key, one that has a non-virtual USB key. So offline computer is totally the way to go, really cheap, and it's fun to tell people about it. But how do you generate a secure passphrase? So this is really hard. People are bad at generating passwords or passphrases. And Snowden tells us that we have to assume that you're significantly paranoid and you're worried about three-letter agencies, you have to assume that your adversary is capable of 1 trillion guesses per second. So what does 1 trillion guesses per second sort of mean? That means that if we want to withstand just 1 year of a brute force attack, we need a password that has 65 bits of entropy. So this raises the problem, how do we measure a password's entropy? How do we make sure that we have a sufficiently long password that is not only long, but also has the required entropy? But we need a random password, because people are incapable of doing this. The first thing that the NSA does is they take Wikipedia, and they take every single combination of every single phrase that's in Wikipedia, and they permute it, and they try that. And then 2 hours later, they say, okay, we'll brute force it. And they do that in all languages. So you need a random password, and if you think about a random password, you read it from, for instance, DevRandom, and you base64 encode it, or some other smart encoding, and you have something that is more or less impossible to memorize. And it's, well, maybe you're committed, right, and you're paranoid, and you're willing to memorize it, but most people are not willing to memorize these things, and then they ought to be a little bit more paranoid than they are. So what do we have to do? We have to encode it smartly. Right, and we can encode it smartly, and there is a well-known protocol for doing it, and it's called Diceware. And Diceware is about not only reading from, for instance, DevRandom, but don't even use your computer to generate the entropy. Take one die and roll it, and now you have, how much entropy do you have? 2.5 bits? Is that right? About 2.5 bits of entropy. So you have to roll this one die multiple times. You can't roll multiple die at once unless you predetermine the order, because that reduces the entropy. So you have to roll one die, and you do that multiple times, and then you get some entropy. So you have, for instance, 10 bits of entropy. That means that we have a number between 0 and 1023. What can we do with a number between 0 and 1023. But we can use it as an index into an array. So we have an array that contains 1024 words that are easy to memorize. And we do this a whole bunch of times. And then we have a few words. For instance, we have something like able, about, above. This is an example of a word list. One of the first three words in a word list. And if we want to get 80 bits of entropy, which is a pretty good passphrase, we just need 8 words. And if you're Snowden, then you want 12 words. But even that's enough, right? 120 bits of entropy, that's secure. So what's an example of a passphrase generated using this approach? Percent, burst, able, smash, opposite, ready, blind, stab. And you can even imagine pictures forming in your mind as I read this blind stab or burst, able, smash, right? You can come up with things that make it easier to memorize this. Right? That's how I do my passphrase. There are no symbols. I just use this list. This is secure against any adversary who knows the word list. So the word list is providing a lower bound on the amount of entropy. If your adversary doesn't know the word list, you have more entropy. Right? Because the adversary doesn't know what the word list is. You do not have to do any more transformations. This is enough. Now, I also use this to generate passphrases for websites. And it turns out that all of these passwords are determined to be very weak and not accepted, which is really bizarre because, right, I know how much entropy is there. The algorithms are stupid, so you have to do some sort of lame transformation, but whatever. Go ahead. No, you have to. So the question was, if you use different languages, do you get more entropy? And the answer is no, you don't, because we're assuming that your adversary knows your word list. I'm sorry? It doesn't matter. As long as your adversary knows the word list, then it's just about choosing the words from the word list. So you're suggesting that you can add more entropy by hiding the word list, but this is just security through obscurity. And security through obscurity is not adding additional security. So it doesn't matter what word list you use, you can use your own word list in whatever language you like, that's easiest for you to memorize, but you can't imagine it adding more entropy. So there was a question over here from earlier, sorry.
So could you create more memorable phrases by adding different word lists with different parts of speeches?
That's kind of kinda cool. Yeah, I've actually spent a few days trying to do that. And it turns out it's not so easy because then when you have verbs, you have to conjugate them, and if you have nouns, you may have to declinate them, and then you have agreement between object and subject, and verb and object, and all sort of stuff. So, in terms of security, it doesn't matter, right? Because we're still assuming that the adversary knows the word list. Okay, you weren't next. I think back there was one. But first, I want everybody to come take a seat. So, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 seats. Come on, guys. Here, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 seats. You over here. Everybody on the right of the camera comes over here. On the left of the camera goes over there. Not until you sit down. I don't take questions from people standing. Unless you're the cameraman. Yeah, good. The guy who was standing before us.
Not really a comment, but we talked about to remember like a unusual sequence like that.
Yeah.
Called memory palace.
Yeah. That's what I was trying to describe. Were you?
Okay.
But memory palace is a technique for memorizing things, and you can imagine a car, and you put one word into the front light and one word into the right. Exactly. You make a story. And so this is a nice way to memorize these things. There were other questions. So I'm all about taking questions. So first you.
So I use a passphrase that's longer or more entropy.
Yeah. Does it have more entropy though?
So
you have a longer passphrase. Does it have more entropy?
Yes.
It has more entropy.
It has different words and so forth.
Yeah, but the words don't matter. They don't affect the entropy.
Well,
Okay, let's assume for now that.
Okay, so you think you're better. Go ahead. No, it's okay.
No, no,
you probably are.
Not necessarily. There's a follow-up.
Okay.
So every time I try to decrypt something and I'm mistyped,
yeah,
I get a feeling there's a field of latency that's probably getting hold of some information or that could be a program that's.
Yeah, so every time you mistype your passphrase, you feel like there's some three-letter agency that's getting access to some data. Well, whenever you type, you already have a problem, which is that the time between each stroke is enough in order to figure out what you're typing. So you're screwed. It doesn't matter. We're all screwed. So if you're worried about the NSA, you absolutely have to be typing in your passphrase when you have a blanket over your head, when you're in the soundproof room, when you absolutely made sure that there are no smartphones in the room, or if they are in the room, you put them into a microwave or something like that. And then, right, and then you might be safe. Might. But this is assuming that your adversary is the NSA, or GCHQ, or BND, or FSB, and for most of us, that's not the case. It can't be GCHQ, I've been told. No, but GCHQ is a three-letter agency. They're also a four-letter word. Are they words? Well, they're working hand in hand with NSA. I don't want to talk about politics. I am completely neutral. I do not talk politics. I.
One of the mismatches between people thinking of the passphrase and the conventional passphrase.
One of the errors in perception when you look at the passphrase is effectively a base 1024 representation of the key, as in hex is a base 16 representation. Yeah. And people are thinking of it as a lexical checker to span the space of base,
right,
128,
yeah,
which is ASCII, or actually base 64, probably, printable ASCII.
Right, you have to think about them as being base 1024. And
they're just symbols.
Then it makes a little bit more sense. But if you're not a computer scientist, then that's hard to explain. So diceware is actually something that's really... Are there more questions? I feel like there were some more hands, so let's do some more questions, and then we'll keep going. Yeah, go ahead.
Can't you generate the word list randomly to hassle the encryption?
It doesn't matter. The question is, can you generate the word list randomly? It doesn't matter. You just have to use one word list from your language of choice, or if you have multiple languages, whatever, and memorize that. It's all about the entropy. It's not about the words. The word list that you use provides a lower bound on the amount of entropy. If you want more entropy, you just add more words. Do not try to add entropy in other ways. You just cannot do it. People are not designed for this. Right? This is how the Germans lost World War II. No, it's true. You're laughing, you think this is a joke, but this is true. The English or the Americans, I don't know exactly who, it was the English. Okay, so the English were able to figure out that the woman who was generating random numbers in Germany for the for their encryption scheme, she had a bias. What?
The bias was the keyboard.
The bias was the keyboard?
Yeah, three successive keys.
You kept the three players.
And the indicators on the front of the message were predictable, not as wide as the
namespace
predictable.
Okay, so apparently there was less entropy. Okay.
In Germany.
All right. Apparently I have the details of the story wrong, but the story right. So two different stories. All right, so I'll keep going, but there are more questions. I saw another hand. Yeah, go ahead.
I was just thinking about it because if I was to explain this to a buddy tomorrow, don't have the slide in front of me. So you can think of the word list as ingredients in your pantry, and then should someone see your pantry, they don't know what meal that you're going to cook with said ingredients. They don't know what you're going to use.
Right. So you can imagine the words being ingredients in your pantry, and even if somebody looks into your pantry, they know what the words might be, but they have to order them and choose, and
That's the entropy, exactly. That's a really nice way of thinking about it. Alright, so now move on. So there are a bunch of different word lists available. There's the old Diceware word list, which contains 8,000 words, and it's a disaster of a word list, in my opinion. It means that you get more entropy per word, but you get words that are more or less impossible to memorize. So, well, they have lots of misspellings and words that you've probably never heard of, and I find using the Diceware word list makes it harder to memorize the passphrases. I like to use passphrases that are easy to remember, things that I'm used to thinking about. PGP, the PGP Corporation developed a biometric word list which contains 512 words. And the idea here is that you actually use half the words for the even words, or the like, imagine that your passphrase contains four words, say. So for 1 and 3, you use the first half, and for 2 and 4, you use the second half of the word list. And they had a linguist who helped develop the word list, and it has this nice property that the words sound very different from each other. And this is nice if you want to tell someone your passphrase, which you don't want to do, right? Right, but you don't want to tell someone your passphrase. I mean, there are other uses for this, but that was a joke. That was my first joke of the evening. So my favorite is the Voice of America's Simple English Word List. This contains 1,500 words, and so you can go ahead and prune that. I made my own personal copy. It doesn't add more entropy, but, you know, I did. Because I have my own program that does this. So the Voice of America's Simple English Word List, it creates words or passphrases that, for an English speaker, are very easy to understand. Of course, in different languages, you also have similar things, and you can make your own word list. So, we've covered how do you protect your key, how do you create a good passphrase, but how do you avoid man-in-the-middle attacks? And this is something that is really, really hard to do. It's hard in the sense that it takes effort, and people don't like to expend effort in order to protect their communication. So, a lot of you probably have Signal installed on your phone, and Edward Snowden has endorsed Signal as being the most secure instant messaging platform that's currently available for smartphones. And that's probably true, but in its default incarnation, you are not actually checking other people's fingerprints. You just go ahead and you enter somebody's phone, the system returns some key to you, more or less, and then you start communicating with the person. And what that means is that you have protection from passive adversaries. It's the same thing as if you do a Diffie-Hellman key exchange. I send a number to you, you send back a number to me. If somebody was in the middle, then they could have intercepted our communication and then exchanged it with their own number, and then as the message came back, rewrote it, and I would never know. So as soon as you have an active adversary, you have to somehow verify your communication partner. And the way this is traditionally done at OpenPGP is that you exchange fingerprints. So you have, for instance, your fingerprint printed on your business card, and you give your business card to someone else. This is a secure channel, right? I'm pretty sure that the NSA is not involved in this motion and somehow rewrote my business card. And then you know exactly what key to expect, and a man in the middle fails. Now maybe you want to communicate with someone that you don't directly know, right? So a friend of a friend. Well, I could ask my friend for Bob's fingerprint, and Alice could reply to me and say, hey, Neal, this is Bob's fingerprint. And then I would say, okay, I trust Alice. Alice got the fingerprint directly from Bob. So now I can send a secure message to Bob. I've authenticated the channel, or Alice has authenticated it for me, and I've authenticated the channel with Alice. And this is more or less the web of trust. It's a little bit more complicated, but that's the web of trust. And then we have key signing parties. So if you want to build the web of trust, we have all of these key signing parties, and all the geeks come together, and they have this little dance, and a ritual, and all the outsiders say, what the hell is going on? That's kind of weird. But the geeks do it, and that's a geek tradition. So if you're a geek, you've done it. If not, you're not a real geek. And for those of you who want to be geeks, we can have a key signing party afterwards. But these key signing parties are really inconvenient. I only have 30 minutes left. We'll see. We'll see what the audience wants. You might have a revolt. We'll do it for another 40 minutes. So key signing parties are for geeks. Exchanging fingerprints in person is inconvenient. So just use the damn telephone, right? If you're going to communicate with someone, and you're going to send them an email, you could just as well call the person and ask for the fingerprint. You're communicating, right? Not hard. And if you know the person, if you've ever met the person, then you'll more or less be able to identify from social cues, including the person's voice, the way the person speaks, whether or not that's the real person. Although we know that the NSA and other agencies have technology that is able to impersonate the voice and all this other stuff, it's unlikely that you're being targeted because the NSA doesn't want to waste their zero-day exploits on you. They might waste them on other people, but these people are taking additional measures. So using the telephone is secure enough for all but the most paranoid, and it's much more secure than no check at all. At this point, you've more or less authenticated the channel, and it is impossible for a man in the middle to intercept your communication, to read it, or to rewrite it. But what about trust and first use? So how many of you use SSH? So I see one person who doesn't, two people who don't use SSH. Three people. That's pretty good. I've seen better, but you're doing well. So the first time that you connect to an SSH host, correct me if I'm wrong, here's what happens. You type in SSH host name, and then SSH displays a warning. This is the first time that you're connecting to this host, this is your fingerprint, and what you type in YES enter. That's what everybody does, right? There are a whole lot of people who don't do that. Why don't you do that? Yeah, I'm sure you know, but you just type in yes. You do. I know. What do I do? I type in yes. No, I check actually. But most people just type in yes. In fact, so I have half an hour. I'm going to tell you a story here. So Peter Gutman, who is a professor of computer science down in New Zealand, he had this great idea. He was going to try to figure out what pieces of the fingerprint do people actually verify. So he went to two big companies. I'm going to assume that it was IBM and some other company, but he didn't tell us this was a big secret. But it had to be IBM. And he went there and he said, I'm doing this study. It's a really great study. We're going to figure out the weaknesses of the fingerprints and how we can figure out what people are actually checking. And I said, oh, this is a great idea. You should do this. And so he went to the IT department. And the IT department said, yeah, we'll help you, no problem. What do we have to do? And he said, how often do people call up and ask for the fingerprint for the host names? And they said, never. And so he knew the project, because he already had it himself, right? They don't check anything. So they didn't check anything. The project was canceled. People don't check this stuff. But nevertheless, TOFU provides real value. And what is the real value that TOFU is providing? It's providing a check over the consistency of a binding between a name and a key. And should this binding change, if a name is suddenly associated with a new key, you get a conflict. And this conflict is telling you that the key has changed for some reason. Either there's a man in the middle attack, or somebody has installed a new version of the key on the server, so some key rotation occurred. Now, it's usually key rotation, but it could be a man in the middle attack. And so it is providing real value. It is not authenticating the connection, right? Authenticating the connection would mean actually checking the fingerprint. It's monitoring this binding. And so it is protecting you, or it's identifying attackers. And this provides real value. And so what I did recently is that I implemented TOFU for OpenPGP. And we do exactly that. We monitor the binding between the email address and the key. And if this changes, then we display a warning. And normally it doesn't change, right? Just like in the SSH case, for the most part, people aren't being man-in-the-middled because the NSA doesn't want to waste their zero-day exploits on you. They want to waste them on other people. They're also not replacing keys, although there is the evil 32 attack that some of you might know about.
Excuse me.
Yeah.
How do you handle things like people with multiple keys for an email, the same email address? Because an attacker can very easily generate a false key with the same email address.
Right, that's what you're monitoring. So, I'm not sure what the question is. You're saying that there are legitimate uses of multiple email address or multiple keys with the same email address?
I'm not saying the uses are legitimate. I'm saying the there has to be some local storage to cache the information. Is that correct?
Right. So you have a TOFU database, and the TOFU database has all the bindings in it, and the binding between the email address and the key. And when you get a new email that you verify, we go ahead and we look. We say, okay, here's the user ID, here's the key. We look at the database. If it's not there yet, then we add it. If it's already there, then we make sure it's the same. If it's not the same, then we display a warning to the user.
Okay, so it's only for verification, it's not for signing.
It's also for encryption. For signing, it doesn't matter, right? Because signing is using your own key. So for encryption, we more or less do the same thing. And the reason that we do it for encryption is because, you do it for encryption anyways, because you don't trust your local key ring. The local key ring is not trusted. It's the signatures that are actually identifying the trust. You can have any key that you want in your key ring, and that doesn't mean anything. But there is an attack that you can do on TOFU, which is you just use a different email address. So for instance, you might generate a key, and instead of sending it to Neal at Walfield, or setting the user ID to neal@walfield.org, which is my primary email address, you might use neal@walfield.com. And then you would send it to one of these nice people, and they would see, it's a new binding, no flag. And so you've tricked those people, you've created a forged key, and there's no conflict because there's a different email address. And if these people normally communicate with me, if they verified a whole bunch of messages or they sent me messages, then what we do is we display some statistics at the top, which show how many encrypted messages / signed messages you have from this key. And so it might be, say, 100 or 101, 102, and then all of a sudden you see this message from Neal and it says, this is a new key. That's kind of weird. This morning I had 103 messages from Neal. There's something going on, and then you squint and you say, .com, okay. So the fundamental difference between the SSH case and the OpenPGP case is that in SSH, it's the user who's typing in the host name, right? And so this is what we refer to as a pet name. And in the OpenPGP case, it's the adversary who provides the name. And so that means the adversary can provide mimicry, right? Neal.walfield.com instead of Neal.walfield.org. That would trick most people, at least people who aren't very conscious of what's going on. And so by providing statistics, then we're able to defeat mimicries. At least we hope to be able to grab the user's attention and say, have the user say, hey, something is a little bit strange here. And these identifiers in the OpenPGP case are referred to as nicknames. So if you know Zuku's triangle, then you know what's going on. If you don't, you can look that up. So if you want to use TOFU today in GPG, you can. It's been supported since December of 2005, so for almost a year. And it's so nice, I highly encourage you to use it. This is way better than just not doing any kind of checks at all. And the reason that TOFU works, even though it's weaker than the Web of Trust, is that TOFU requires no user support. It only requires user support when something is going wrong, when there is a conflict. And if you want to enable GPG.conf, if you want to enable TOFU, then in your GPG.conf file, then you change the trust model to TOFU plus PGP. Now that's kind of a weird name for TOFU, right? And the reason that it's a weird name is because it's not TOFU, it's TOFU
plus PGP is TOFU plus Web of Trust, which means that we incorporate both the Web of Trust and TOFU into the decision-making process. So how do you manage your keys? Well, you get a signed message and then you fetch the key. But do you refresh keys regularly? So you should, right? There are new preferences, there may be revocation certificates. And how do you do this? Well, one way you can do it is to use gpg --refresh keys. You shouldn't do this because then you leak your entire social graph. So the key server then knows exactly who you are because you just told it who your favorite 100 contacts are. If you want to do it, you can install Parsimony. Parsimony uses Tor, and it uses a memoryless distribution in order to determine the time between key refreshes, which means that it's more or less impossible to link different refreshes together. In the very near future, Dir Manager is going to do this all automatically. So we're making Parsimony redundant, which is a nice thing because, again, no support required, automatically on by default. What happens when the government comes to you and they say, we want to decrypt this message? Something is wrong, you've encrypted this message, we have a warrant, we have an NSL, we need your key. It's on the slide, it's not a quiz. I'm just building up suspense. But go ahead, tell me. Tell me, what do I do?
Are you going to say, what is the Fifth Amendment?
No. No. You don't disclose your private key. You don't have to. Because if they want a particular message, you can just use the session key, right? If you all remember way at the beginning, this hybrid encryption, that means that we generate a session key, a new session key for every single message. The session key is used to encrypt the message, and then the session key is encrypted for each recipient. That means that when the government comes to you, you just give them the damn session key. And then all they're able to decrypt is that one particular message. You don't have to provide them with your private key, which then gives them access to everything else. Sorry?
The point is, you need to script this.
You don't have a script. Look, all you have to do is do GPG, show session key, and you have no scripts required. Yeah. Oh, okay, if you have 10,000 messages. Right. So even if you have 10 messages, you can do this for N messages. Okay. Another hot tip, right? Who runs a backup? Wow, not so many people. So there are more people who use SSH than do backups. In fact, almost none of you do backups. Wow. Anyways, for you 10 people who do backups, you ought to consider excluding random seed from your backups because this is the pool that we use in order to generate session keys and private keys. Now, we don't just use this the way it is. We always do a little bit of mixing. But we don't do that much mixing because mixing is very expensive. So just exclude this to make it completely impossible that just by mistake you get the exact same session key which you complete testing. Yeah.
Why are you not encrypting your backups?
I'm sorry?
Why are you not encrypting your backups?
It's not about encrypting backups, right? So this is about you restore a backup and then you use the same pool state in order to generate a new nonce or a new session key. In particular, well, okay, if you use the same session key, it's not a complete disaster, but if you use the same nonce, and you're using something like DSA, then you're screwed, right? You just revealed your private key. So it's really unlikely this is going to happen, because whenever we use the random seed, we load it and we stir in some additional entropy, but it's low-quality entropy. When we generate private keys, then we always do a long stirring and we make it all very secure, but it's just too expensive only. So key expiry, if you're going to generate a key, use your expiration date. Just do it, because everybody forgets to save their revocation certificate. Right? How many people have saved their revocation certificate? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. If you're using GPG 2.1 and you have backups, then you've definitely saved your revocation certificate because these days we automatically generate a revocation certificate by default. But if you have an older version, then that was not the case. And then inevitably, there are whole lots of key keys out there from people who forgot to generate a revocation certificate or forgot to save it or whatever. Just use an expiration date and then things get better. And the thing with expiration dates is that you can easily extend them. It's really trivial to do it using GPG. You just do GPG dash dash edit key. You can change the expiration date and everything works. And the nice thing about having an expiration date is it forces people to update your key, and then they know what you support, all of the nice new hot algorithms, and that's great. What about key rotation? So somehow your key has gotten old, it's not big enough anymore, you still have a 1024-bit key, or you have a 2048-bit key, but you decided that it is perhaps compromised, who knows what's going on. So you generate a new key. What is the right way to generate a new key? Well, you of course use 10key, but you're going to use the same email address probably. And in this case, what you really, really want to do is generate cross signatures. So you want your new key to sign your old key and your old key to sign your new key. This is the only way for a machine to know that these two keys belong to the same person. If you're not doing this and you're only using the revocation message, then you're telling humans what the new key is, but you're not telling the machines. So, we're 3/4 of the way done. We have an hour left to go. I'm just going to tell you a few neat tricks and then we're done. So, SSH. Everybody uses SSH, except for 3 people here. So, you're all using keys, right? Who's using keys? Keys are awesome. Yeah. Okay, so passwordless login. But you know, you can do even better than SSH keys. You can use GPG keys. So if you have ever accidentally entered the wrong password into when you've connected to an SSH server, then you disclose your password, that's a pain in the butt because now you can change your password on 50 computers. Because we all use different passwords on different computers, right? No, I don't. I use the same password on pretty much every single computer, which is no password. I use keys, right? You should disable passwords. Seriously. Okay. So, where does OpenSSH store the private keys that you use? On your hard drive. But all of you have been so inspired that you've gone out and you've gotten one of these nice little tokens. What are you doing? You don't want SSH to store your private keys on your hard drive. These keys are only protected by a passphrase, and yet you have your GPG key. What can you do? You can use your smart key because GnuPG implements the SSH agent protocol, which is really cool. And it does all the caching and it works beautifully. So it can take advantage of the authentication key that's stored on your smart card. And how do you configure it? It's really easy. You add enable SSH support to your gpg-agent.com file. You restart GPG agent. You can use SSH add minus L to figure out what your key ID is on your public key on your smart card is. You add that to the authorized keys file, and you make sure to set the SSH auth socket to the appropriate socket in your .bashrc file. And then you connect to a host, you're prompted to insert your smart card, and all the authentication happens automatically. It's really cool. How about remote GPG agent? That's kind of cool. That's really cool. How many people know about remote GPG agent other than me? 1, 2. That's really cool. 2 people know about this. Awesome. This is not a new feature, but nobody knows about it except for 3 people in this room. But now, 150 more people have learned about it. So, GPG agent can run on a remote computer or as a different user ID. So how do you do it? You have an insecure PC, and then you have a secure PC, or you have an insecure user ID and a secure user ID. So for instance, you create a new user called GPG, and then you add the following to your gpg-agent.com file. This is this extra socket line. And then you do some port forwarding. This requires OpenSSH 6.7 or newer, which even Debian Stable has, so it's not a big deal. Everybody has this. So, that's it. I'm willing to take questions, but my slides are online at gnupg.org under some really super long URL. So use the search engine of your preference to just search for my name and GnuPG, and you'll find them. Additional resources are available at Rise Up for the beginners, And for the people who want to know what the truly paranoid, and I'm not truly paranoid, I'm only a little bit paranoid, what the truly paranoid do, you should read this from the group. It's some pretty crazy stuff. All right, so you weren't first, I think you were first, but everybody,
he was first,
but everybody's gonna get a chance to ask questions.
What are we doing to get ahead of quantum computing?
What do we do for quantum computing? Yeah, quantum computing is interesting, right? So all of a sudden, we have DJP who goes ahead and creates this beautiful ECC stuff, right? And it works. So what's the problem with RSA? This is a redundant question, right? I'm gonna tell you exactly what it is. RSA has a problem that every single year, multiple times per year, somebody comes up with some new time attack, some side channel attack, who knows what's going on. RSA is not so nice, but ECC, it's beautiful. You just cannot screw up the implementation. Well, you can, but it's so much harder to screw up the implementation of ECC than RSA. RSA is hard to do right. ECC, really easy to do right when you're using DJB's curves. And then, these three-letter agencies tell us that we have to use post-quantum computing now. Maybe they're trying to sow the seeds of paranoia. In order to get us to use post-quantum crypto, which is hard to implement and has bugs. I'm not sure. Now, there's definitely, it's good that we're doing research on post-quantum crypto, and we want to deploy post-quantum crypto, but we believe that the near future is ECC. If you're generating keys today, you're probably safer using ECC than using post-quantum crypto stuff. Just because getting the post-quantum crypto right is so hard, it has had significantly less peer review, whereas the ECC stuff is pretty bulletproof. That's our position, and I'm sticking by it for the next 6 months. Brian,
you mentioned that we should use subkeys. Can you talk a little bit more about how the actual mechanics of that and what you can and can't do with them?
So subkeys. So you have three different types of keys normally when you're using OpenPGP. You have your certification key that is only used for certifying subkeys and certifying other keys. So when you assign somebody's key, you're using your certifying key, and that's your primary key. And then there are, okay, I guess there are four types. Then there's the signing key that you can use. A signing key is used for signing other, for signing messages. You have an encryption key that other people use to encrypt messages to you. And then you have an authentication key, which is used, for instance, for SSH. And the reason that you want to keep these things separate is because when you address a key, when you name it, then you use the primary key's key ID or a fingerprint in order to talk about the key. You normally don't use the subkey's fingerprint. And so the nice thing about that is that you can go ahead and retire your subkeys without retiring your primary key. So you have a short expiration and you use a sufficient number of bits for today, and then 4 years later, you decide, well, the 2K key, that's not enough anymore. I want a 4K RSA key. You expire the subkey. You create a new subkey. And nothing has changed. People don't have to figure out what your new key ID is and download that. They only have to do a refresh, and everything automatically works. So this is the reason that we have subkeys. And the other reason that we have subkeys is that you can't use the same key material. Well, you can, but you shouldn't. You shouldn't use the same key material for signing and for encryption, because there is a theoretical weakness where if you sign using an encryption key, you might be able to recover some bits of the private key. Who knows to what degree that's practical, but we're paranoid, right? We need to protect not only people that are talking with their lovers, but also people like Snowden who are talking with journalists. You have another follow-up.
It's a follow-up, yeah. I can say it later.
So if you have your subkey on your portable laptop and your master key on your like air-gapped secure machine, what can you do when you're on your laptop? Can you decrypt messages? Can you do any, you know?
So if you have the subkeys, then you can do pretty much anything except for doing for signing other people's keys. So to sign somebody's key, you need the certification key. Likewise, to create additional subkeys, you need the certification key. Okay. So you're following me, so I'm not going to keep going to the front of the room. Yes?
My question is in regards to the section on good practices. You brought up a scenario about not giving up a private key. So you mentioned the session key. So if there's a message between like me and you, and a three-letter agency comes in and they're asking for it, neither of us are revealing our private key, but we give them the session key. How do I'm trying to understand the chain of events. Like, does a remote server store the session key and can decrypt with that session key? Like, by handing over the session key, how do they then decrypt our message?
So what the scenario that we're considering here is that the law agency comes to you and they say, we need you to decrypt this one message. Now, you can go ahead and give them some text, the clear text, but how do they know that that really came from this encrypted law? And so you give them the session key and they're able to decrypt exactly this one message. If they want to intercept all of the traffic, so every single message, then they absolutely need your private key. The session key is just for one message. Does that make sense?
Well, and the question is how you get the session key when a year and a half later.
Well, I have the message, right? So I can... The session key is stored inside of the message.
Well, where is... is the session key stored in the packet when you're transferring the...
Yeah, it's encrypted. So when I encrypt a message to you, then the session key is encrypted using your public key. So the FBI would come to you and they say, we want to decrypt this message. You would use your private key to decrypt the session key, and you would give them the session key. They would take the session key and they could use the session key to decrypt the actual message.
So they would take the session key plus my public key to decrypt the message?
Well, they have your public key. Is your public key public?
Well, that's what I mean.
Well, they don't need your public key. They don't. Even if they didn't have your public key, the session key is sufficient.
Got it.
Okay. That's with what, sir? No, there's no forward secrecy. So GPG doesn't support forward secrecy because we're doing offline stuff. You can't do key negotiations, so it means that it's impossible to have ephemeral keys. And without ephemeral keys, you can't really do forward secrecy. Now, I say that even though it is possible to do forward secrecy using GnuPG, because there is some research that's recently been done by Matt Green, and he came up with this new scheme called puncture encryption, which uses attribute-based encryption in order to do some kind of funky stuff. But it's not implemented, and even if it were implemented, it's very difficult to use. You have to have secure storage, and it's rather complicated. So most people won't be using it, and if you really want to do something like forward secrecy, then the best way to do it is to do constant key rotation. And the easiest way to do constant key rotation is to revoke your subkey and create a new subkey every, say, 3 or 6 months. And that way, if your subkey is somehow compromised, then they'll only be able to decrypt the traffic that you've generated in, say, the last 3 months. Yeah?
Did you come across any, since you brought up SSH, did you come across any places using SSH fingerprint records in DNS?
So I'm not really familiar with that. So
you can actually store the host.
Okay, I know about that.
What kind of request do DNS say?
Yeah, the DNS site was a disaster. Sorry. if you're going to use X509 with central authorities, that means that you're using semantic. And do you all know the story of semantic? I will tell you the story of semantic. Do we have time for the story of semantic?
We should probably wrap up and ask the questions.
People want to hear the story of semantic. So semantic is a really big American company, right? And they generate 50% of the certificates that are used by websites these days. 50%. And you know what they did last year? They just generated thousands of keys for websites that they weren't authorized to generate keys for. And they put them on the internet, and people were using this, right? Semantic
is a big American company. Now, how many CAs are there in the world? Thousands. Including Church Trust. There's another good story there, but I won't tell that story. There are thousands of CAs in the world. These are run by dictators, like in Turkey. Yeah, Erdogan is a dictator. They're run by places like China, every place. And your browser trusts these things. Right? You're screwed. If you're using X509, you're just don't do it. What?
The post office in China is also a CA.
The post office in China is also a CA. There are so many CAs. And nobody's verifying this stuff.
Huh? Post office. Yeah.
It doesn't matter. It's just there's so many. There's so many and they're all trusted equally. Just a disaster. Yeah, Firefox doesn't trust your OS certificates anymore. They just provide their own. So X509 is a disaster.
So if you have encrypted something for, let's say, a few people, and you want to encrypt it for two more people, let's say, is there a better way of going about it rather than decrypting what you have encrypted and then re-encrypt
it? It's not directly supported, but in theory, you could add an additional header, so you just decrypt the session key and re-encrypt it, but that's not something we directly support because it's not a common use case. Certainly, it's reasonable to write some code that would do that. In fact, actually, there's a secret tool. We have a secret tool. It's called GPG Compose and GPG Split. So if you use GPG Split, then you can split a message with all individual packets. Then you can extract the session key. You can use GPG Compose to create a public key encrypted session key packet using the specified session key. And then you can reassemble the whole thing. So you can script it. You can script it today using our secret tool. You have to build GnuPG with enable maintainer mode, and then you get this tool called GPG Compose, and then you can do that.
Yes.
So do people want to ask more questions, or do they want me to ask questions?
Well, we have a time frame at the bar, so I'd love it if we can actually get you at the bar, and then we'll come up to you and assault you with it.
But I'm having so much fun here. I am, you're a great audience. This is too fun. I like having more people. So I gave this talk in Baltimore 2 days ago, and 7 people showed up. I was really sad. I figured there's so much political activity going on in Baltimore that more people would come. Right? Yeah, three-letter agencies down there too. I thought they would come and listen. Question number one, right?
No, quick note, don't call up the answer, raise your hand. I think it looks like Neil's got the mic, let him call on you. And that's going to be whoever answers the question, raise their hand.
Well, all right.
Because people get really upset when no one knows who's shouting the answers.
All right, these are hard questions, so if you weren't paying attention, you got no chance. But you can use the internet, okay? You can all cheat and use the internet, get your smartphones out, get ready. What is my GID?
ABC123.
Go.
ABC123.
No.
Oh.
Get out your smartphone. Look at my key ID. Go to SKS pool or SKS key server. Interact with key server. Find my key ID. I said it during the talk. I said it multiple times.
What's your email?
Oh, come on. Just look at my name. What's my name? Go.
AAC3243630529.
Yep. Alright.
Wait, can you
say that without looking at it? No, I wrote it down over here. Alright, next question. Everyone ready? You will also need your smartphone for this exercise, unless you were really paying attention, okay? When was RFC 4880 published?
2007.
Hey, I have to call on you. Go.
2007.
Oh, yeah. All in. Do you want it? All right, take it.
Don't call up the answer. So we should disqualify him? You're disqualified. You call up the answer. He's disqualified. Call up the answer. I will come up with a new question. Tell me what MDS stands for, and then you get the book. No, you lose.
Yes.
Come on. This is actually
one way.
Sorry. There are rules. There are rules. We need to respect the rules. All right, what does MDS stand for? Yeah. Yeah, you win. Modification detection system. Okay. What is the name of the smart card that Neva-san developed? Go.
GNU-K.
That's pretty close. GNU-K. You win. All right. What is the name of the key derivation function defined by RFC 4880?
S2K.
You win, S2K. All right, now for the last question. This one's a really hard one. Everyone get ready. What is my key ID?
A,
you can give me the short key ID. You're all paying attention, right? Come on, I just...
Your email address.
No, it's not my email address. My email address is not my key ID. You already got a book. You have a chance. Come on, quick. It was already answered. If you were paying attention, you would have known, because we've already said I said it, we said it a minute ago. Guys. All right, yeah.
6C65259.
Huh? No. Yeah, go ahead. 6300529. Yep, you won. 6300529. I already asked all the questions.
So, here we are.
Yeah, okay. We're going to wrap.
Hi, everyone. So, we're going to be heading over to Ken's bar corner. Ken, something or other. It's right over on Green and West Broadway. It's right here on the corner next to the coffee room. I'm so sorry. It's like not Keynes, it's Kansas, right? Yeah, just go out the door to the left and cross the street to the right. And you can give me all of your questions when you get there. And he has an answer.